But long as there are stars above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, well, life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me, so what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you.
ready?
I haven't done that. There's been no music.
Yeah.
The music is playing out. Yeah, like about 2 hours ago.
Yeah, and they're playing the Doors.
Okay, are we ready? Are we good to go? Okay, guys, if I could welcome you all to the FCCT. Quiet, please. Quiet. We're going. So if I could welcome you all to the FCCT tonight, this is the wake for Nate Thayer. We do these wakes from time to time when a particularly treasured member of the club passes on. Nate was on the board in... Quiet, please. In 1999, I think he was a vice president, when Heather Kelly was in charge, and we had some of the most riotous board meetings in the club's history at that time. We've got people joining us from overseas, and they'll be appearing soon. But I'd like, first of all, to go to Rob Thayer, who is Nate's older brother. Sounds very like Nate when he speaks. Nate had three siblings. He was the third. Rob's the oldest. There are two sisters, Marion and Meg, who've outlived him. And his father was Harry E.T. Thayer, who was a very distinguished Foreign Service officer with the American. He was ambassador in Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Beijing. So there's a long history of international affairs in the family. And Rob Thayer was also very active in this part of the world along the border. Border Relief was instrumental in the repatriation of Cambodian refugees under UNC TAC, the biggest busing operation in world history, and spent 7 years subsequently in Cambodia with the Red Cross. So Rob, can you hear me clearly?
Yes, great. I'm Nick, loud and clear.
Well, welcome to the club. We thought it was appropriate that we would kick off with a member of Nate's family talking about him. So away you go.
Yeah, thank you, Dominic. Thank you all. I wish I could be there with you in person. I'm here in Cape Cod, where I've been since Nate died. So good to be with you all. Dominic, thanks for letting me share this moment with you all. On behalf of the family. And I want to thank, there are a lot of people to thank, but just to mention a few, some folks actually, including Mike Shankman on the screen, have been able to be with Nate in person in recent months. And that was deeply meaningful to him. Others were Francis Moriarty. Francis, I don't know if you're on or not, Rod Weber, Ross Bluestein and others, and others that I'm not remembering or mentioning. And also, so importantly to him, he's been housebound, not mobile at all for many months, seriously ill, as you all know. But all those phone calls, and I was in the room with them for so many of them, fielding phone calls from so many of you from all over the world, that was a very meaningful part of his last months as well. Also, a very special thanks to the nearly 200 people who contributed to his GoFundMe account. Thanks to Diamond Liu and to James Movenon and others. That was a lifeline for Nate that allowed him to pay his bills and avoid eviction and remain in his small cottage, his rented cottage here on Cape Cod, where he spent his last months and where he died last Tuesday. So deep thanks to all the people who stayed connected to Nate and helped him in his last period of his life, which was very difficult, obviously. And I'll glance down at my notes occasionally because there are things I want to be sure not to forget to mention. Nate had big dreams and some of them came true. have to let the emotion pass through me or I'll just be blabbering. But I remember when the dream started, when the Cambodia dream started for him. He was living at Lyne Street in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And I was with him, and then Prince Norodom Ranariddh was in Lowell, Massachusetts, where, as I remember, and there still are something, tens of thousands of Cambodian Americans there. So then Prince Ranariddh was there meeting the Cambodia diaspora, and the 20 something, you know, the young Nate Thayer somehow got himself invited there, and then it ended up at the dinner table with Prince Ranariddh, then Prince Ranariddh and his team. And of course, Nate, you know, the young Nate, who is this kid, was peppering them with questions. And afterward, Prince Ranariddh told his aides, he said, sorry, he said, pay attention to this guy. Help this guy. Give this guy the information he needs. And about the same time, Nate came home. I was at his Lyne Street apartment, and he had drafted up, again, still a kid that not many people had heard of. He didn't have a name for himself, but he did a little analysis of the KPNLF. I don't know if he published it or what he did with it, but he had a couple of pages, and it was pretty well done. But as his older brother, you know, I was looking at it and thinking, you know, this needs a lot of work. And I was ready to take a red pen to it and help him with it. And he wasn't going to have any of that at all. He didn't want his older brother. And looking back on it, you know, that was exactly right. Let this guy run with it. This kid's got a dream. Let him pursue his dream. So during the last 6 months, I've spent as much time as I've been able to with Nate. I live down in the DC area, but I've come up here, spent as much time as I could. And in November, he was extremely lucid. I was here after Thanksgiving, and he was very lucid, very talkative, very animated. We spent a lot of time together, most of it in his living room. He used to love for people, Mike Schenkman on the line did it. He loved to be taken down to the beach with his dog, Lamont. But at the end, he couldn't even do that. He was really housebound in his house. So we spent a lot of time in his living room. And we reminisced about everything, childhood, personal reminiscence, professional reminiscence. We were together in the Boston area in the late 70s, Thailand in the 80s, Cambodia in the 90s, and then, you know, spent as much time as possible together back in the States, where he's spent most of his time since returning from Asia. And I ran a voice recorder for many, many hours with him in October and November. And when things got really personal, or since we were talking about something very sensitive or personal, he didn't want any of that. You know, Nate, he wanted it all out there. During the last months, it was actually fascinating being with him there, because his phone was always ringing and many of you were on the other end. I excused myself when it seemed too personal, but I was in the room there with him and he'd put it on speaker. And, you know, he got calls from friends, colleagues, acquaintances, journalists, relief workers, right-wing extremists, left-wing extremists, because, you know, Nate, he would talk to everybody. Former spies, many of them friends, family friends. And it was a fascinating time to spend with Nate toward the end of his life. And now I'm so thankful that I made that time, because there wasn't going to be another opportunity. Michael Hayes You said it exactly right. Nate was a loner who hated being alone. He craved connection with people, but he wasn't willing to give up 1 ounce of his independence. So think about that, how that works. You crave connection with people, but you're not going to give an inch. So, you know, that can make relationships difficult, but, you know, that was one of Nate's great qualities. He was insistent, you know, on being himself. He didn't compromise much. And, you know, that wasn't always a good thing, but that's who he was. My last visit with him, I'm going to wrap up because we need to hear from all of you. And I know, Dominic, you said this is going to be conversational. And I think that's a great, the informality of it is what Nate would have wanted. I'll just finish a few thoughts quickly. My last visit with him over New Year's, he was really struggling. I was with him until Sunday, New Year's Day, and he was really struggling. He could no longer use his phone or his computer. His hands weren't working. He had bad circulation problems, and his eyesight was going related to his diabetes. So you can imagine how devastating that was for somebody who deeply needed to be connected with people. He was losing that ability to stay connected with people. He knew he was dying, and he was very afraid of dying, and he fought it to the very end, to the very last moment. He fought it. He did not want to die. And at the end, I've shared this with some of you, but he was kind of in rebellion against the medical profession, and he varied from honoring his doctors and the amazing professionals who kept them alive for as long as they did. But in the end, he was in full rebellion. He was refusing to go to the doctor for weeks. He should have been in the hospital. Anybody else would have been in the hospital. He was insistent on being home. He went off all his medications. He wasn't taking any medication. And he told me they gave him a wheelchair, and he took that. This was Nate. He took that wheelchair to the end of a pier. And he threw it in the Atlantic Ocean. The last thing I want to say is just to mention to people that there will be, I'm sure there will be many celebrations of Nate. I don't like to quote Mao Zedong, but he said, let 100 flowers bloom. And that's what I've told people we should do with Nate. If somebody wants to celebrate Nate, that's why I love this event. Let them celebrate Nate. And I'm sure there will be many, you know, many variations of that. But in the spring, we're not sure the date yet, but I'm working with a couple of Nate's close colleagues and friends to organize a public event in Washington, D.C. It'll be open to all. It'll be inclusive of media folks, relief folks, friends, family, whoever. So you'll hear more about that, I think, within 2 weeks. Thanks to those who have offered to help with that. Once we settle on a date and a venue, and there will be a Zoom link for the many people who won't be able to be there in person. Once we settle on a date and a venue, we'll put that out. And of course, all are welcome to join that. Dominic, thank you so much. Thanks to all of you. Thanks to those of you there in Bangkok. And let me turn it back over to all of you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Rob. Right, we're now going to go to Singapore, where we have a recorded message from David McCage, who was with one of the founding members of Asiaworks, and was, of course, the cameraman for the show trial of Pol Pot, which was Nate's great scoop, and we're going to hear more about that afterwards from Mark Leban. But first of all, David.
This is David McCage in Singapore. I'm sorry I can't make it to the FCCT tonight, and in the wake of Nate's death, I wanted to share some thoughts about his life. I was asked last week by a reporter about Nate's legacy. That's very hard. Yes, we did the Pol Pot trial story. Yes, we got the Pol Pot interview. And yes, we were there for the death of Pol Pot. Those are all amazing stories, history-making things. And the stories behind those stories could fill a book. But when I think about legacy, I have to think about what got us into journalism in the first place, the chance to make a difference. So for me, it's the body of work Nate did before that that stands out. From 1986 to 1991, we spent a lot of time covering the Cambodian guerrillas, a lot of time. Think walking from the Thai border to Angkor Wat so they could prove how much control they had of the Cambodian countryside. Those two-week trips were the exception rather than the norm, but you get the idea. Our coverage kept the Cambodia story alive and in the court of public opinion, and by extension, influenced policy and did make a difference. That story and the relationships we built all those years ago paved the way for Nate's Pol Pot story, a journalistic coup truly 10 years in the making. Nate and I mostly fell out of touch when I moved to Singapore in 2001, and there are others who could speak to the last 20 years of his life better than I. I know he struggled with the same demons many of us do, and I know that in the end he succumbed to them. We've lost a good friend. Today we're here to celebrate his life, but I will miss the stories he didn't get a chance to tell. Farewell, friend.
Thank you, David McCage. So now we're going to go back to 1997, which was a momentous year in Cambodia and the region. And the backdrop basically was that ASEAN was about to absorb Myanmar, Laos, and Cambodia to make the ASEAN 10. And there was huge build-up to this. And Ranarid and Hun Sen started rattling each other's cages. And Ranarid's excuse for reconnecting with the Khmer Rouge and negotiating with them was to basically give some kind of gift to ASEAN. And of course, the whole thing backfired, and we had the Pol Pot follies going on, news of Pol Pot rattling around in the jungle with a drip on. And then the two parties, the Royalists and CPP, clashed. And that happened on the 5th of July. And a lot of us were locked out. I was covering for Asia Week at that time, and I couldn't get in until the Thursday. And when I landed at Pochentong, the airport had basically been destroyed, and there were all these people trying to get out of the country. And in the front of the queue was Nate. And he used to call me the enemy. And he would do things like barbecue my stories in Asia Week at parties in Phnom Penh. But actually, we got on fine. And so I saw Nate there, and this look on his face was honestly the last person on earth he wants to see. So I shouted at him, "Nate, you're going the wrong way. The story's here." And he sort of fended me off. And I was completely wrong, because what was happening was that Nate was on his way out of Cambodia to get up onto the border, because he knew he was in with a chance to interview Pol Pot. And so the laugh's on me. But anyway, well done, Nate. Now, this is a story, as I've said before, McCage was the cameraman that went in for the show trial, but there was another cameraman involved, and that's our own Mark Leban, who will now take up the story of what was going on.
Thanks, Dominic, and thanks for everybody for coming. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'll just pick up chronologically. Asiaworks started in December 96, and we're talking now July 97. I had known Nate in the early 90s, and he came to us and said, you know, he had an opportunity to go see Pol Pot, and of course, frankly, we took it with a grain of salt. It just didn't seem possible, because it was the big get. You know, no one could imagine sitting down with Pol Pot. But because of his relationship with Dave McCage, who was my business partner in Asiaworks, Nate came to us, and he and Dave set off. We had no expectations, but they returned with the show trial. That was in July, and you know, created, it was the scoop of the century. That's the way it was, that's what it was called, and frankly, probably was. I mean, I don't think there was another interview ever to rattle the global world, journalistic world at the time. So subsequent to that, now Nate and Dave filmed the trial, which was amazing, and they came out with the footage. ABC, Nightline, Ted Koppel called. Nate decided that Ted was the right guy to go with. And the one thing that was missing, of course, was the interview. And I think Nate took a lot of flack for that, in perhaps from Far Eastern Economic Review, or maybe just internally, he just felt like he just didn't get the interview. And so despite all the messiness around the ABC sale of the footage of the show trial, Nate was determined, he was a dog with a bone, to get the interview, and he chased it. And in October 97, he thought he had it. And we went up to the border, we went to Surin, and I recall sitting in the hotel in Surin, in the lobby with Nate, drinking a double scotch, of course, and the reception was behind me, and Nate was sitting in front of me, and he just went white. Because behind me, at the reception, was Elizabeth Becker, Stephen Hedder, who was the academic, and a videographer checking into the same hotel. We were supposed to see Pol Pot in the morning. Nate told me, let's get up, let's get out of here. And he went back to his room, and he just worked the phones, and then he managed to block Elizabeth Becker from getting in for the Pol Pot interview, talking to his Khmer Rouge contacts, talking to the Thai military. Elizabeth Becker probably got the message that she wasn't going to go in the morning, and she's also a tenacious person, and she, as the story goes, called Madeleine Albright, woke her up in the middle of the night to say, you know, this guy is blocking me from an interview that I had set up with Pol Pot. But, and she called the Thai military and told them that she would expose their complicity with the Khmer Rouge. Probably the wrong thing to do, because that probably sealed her fate more than what Nate did. But we got in a truck that morning and we drove into An Long Veng, which was, for me, amazing to see the place. I'd been in Cambodia in the early 90s and, you know, had met Nate then and felt honored to be with him and David on this journey. And we spent the day in An Long Veng, and we were taken around, and it was a Khmer Rouge village. There was no center to avoid government bombing. There were burned out tanks, lots of logs that were blocked from going into Thailand, folks running around in Khmer Rouge outfits, fishing. At the time, Tamok was running An Long Veng. There was no hunting, so that meant that there was lots of wildlife. There was no, unlike the rest of Cambodia, there were no corner stores and motorcycles and Coca-Cola and any of that crap. It was remarkable. We thought, we had lunch with Yang Siri, Q Sampan, Tam Mok. It was surreal. But time was running out, and we thought, you know, it was sort of mid-afternoon, and we were thinking, where's Pol Pot? Nate was saying, where's Pol Pot? We were supposed to talk to Pol Pot, and they kept kind of blowing us off, and we were getting the distinct impression that we weren't going to see Pol Pot. The Khmer Rouge told us, we'd like you to stay for the evening. The Thai military escorts with us said, you're not going to stay for the evening. So we had to leave. And on our way out, as we, felt we were going back to Thailand, we were back going back the route that we came in, and there was a pagoda, and we stopped, and Pol Pot was sitting in the pagoda. I've put together a little short video, well, Asiaworks video, it's about 6 or 7 minutes, I think, with Nate and Pol Pot from the interview. Perhaps I don't think a lot of people have seen this actually, because the show trial was the big deal, but the interview didn't really get a lot of public exposure. But it definitely shows Nate in action, in situation. So Julian, if you could hit that.
I think that you can raise all the questions at one time, if you like.
I can explain your job.
Up to you. You can raise one question, one after another, or you can raise all the questions.
First of all, as you well know, most of the world thinks that you're responsible for the deaths of hundreds of thousands of innocent Cambodians who didn't deserve to suffer. Do you feel that you were indeed responsible for crimes against humanity, against your own people?
I would like to say first that my conscience. Everything I have done and I have contributed to do is first for the nations and for the people and for the race of Cambodia.
Your last senior comrades, the top standing committee, has rejected you. I interviewed Tom earlier today, who condemned you, and interviewed Yeng Suri, who's also condemned you. Does that make you sad that your top last loyalists have in fact condemned you politically?
Everyone has the right to do so. But for me, I feel that I made mistake, but there is another aspect that I made contributions. Whatsoever, I'm over. The order, they have the duty to do the utmost to save Cambodia.
If you could do anything different in your life, if you could change something you did, or redo history, what would it be?
No.
You would do nothing different.
No, I'm not going to do like I did before. Since 1975, I perceived the problems. That is why I sent my foreign minister to Thailand. I think about that. Soon after the Vietnamese invasion, we had the program for the front. We renounced communism. We renounced the Communist Party.
But did you really renounce communism, or was it a tactical move?
It is
not a tactical. It is not a tactical because the life of the nations and the people command us to do so. We have to mobilize the national forces, and we have to mobilize the support from the world community. Witness is that I went abroad and we established relations with the persons abroad, and everybody talk about that.
They asked me
whether I carried out the struggle or not, and I told them that yes, I have to carry out the struggle. If not, then I would have no nation. Secondly, we have to rely on you. And we are not going back to the old regime. Not only me, but everybody thinks that way.
What would you like to say to Cambodians who live in other parts of Cambodia not under the control of democratic Kampuchea?
ទី 1 ជីវិតរបស់ខ្ញុំ បាន រួម ចំណែក តស៊ូ ជាមួយ ជាតិ ជាមួយ ប្រជាជន
And you gave me opportunity to make some clarification.
ដោយ សតិចិត្ត
To stress that first, I devote my life to contribute to the struggle.
ដោយ សតិចិត្ត ចំពោះ ជាតិ ចំពោះ ប្រជាជន
From my bottom, from the bottom of my heart toward the nation, to people, and to the rank and file.
That's
the first thing. The second thing is that when we put in our policy into practice, there are two aspects. First, our movement, like all movement around the world, we were quite young to say so. But we have also been put as a pressure on us. Pressure were put on us. We have to sell them little by little. But in the settlement of that problem, a mistake was committed. I admit for that, and I also admit when I wrote that book. Anyone has the right to accuse me on that.
Hey, khiem vinh ye. Khiem sdai ta khiem mun mien pisot krup kran damai thoe mchach lue chalana.
For me, what I feel sorry is that I don't have enough experience to master on the situation.
Ka pan tae tet ta phiep muoy tiet dae khiem kit knong chich kit knong chat khiem tha khiem
Another aspect is that I made contribution, and that contribution with the population, with the people, with the rank and file, to prevent Cambodia from becoming part of Vietnam.
Yeah, sorry. If I can just, I know we've got a lot to get through tonight, but very quickly, I went to the border one more time with Nate, And Pol Pot was clearly not well. And I met with, or Nate met with his Khmer Rouge contact. I was with him. And we went somewhere, you know, in the jungle, sat down. And they asked Nate if we could take Pol Pot. I mean, they were going to give us Pol Pot. And they said, can you take him to Bangkok and hand him over to the Americans? You can imagine, you know, I was just imagining this, you know, driving back to Bangkok with Pol Pot in the back seat with a heart condition, you know, what the hell are we doing? Nate called the ICRC. Nate called, he tried to work something out, but couldn't. And it was only a few days later that Pol Pot was dead. So a writer somewhere in this whole, you know, whirlwind wrote, the man who killed Pol Pot, and I always thought that was pretty accurate because we were told that Pol Pot had heard, he was an avid radio listener and had heard on VOA, Khmer VOA, that there were moves to hand him over to some international court, The Hague, whatever. And that was too much for him, and either he took his own life or someone arranged to take his life from him. But that car ride from Surin with Pol Pot to Bangkok never happened.
Right. So that's 98, it's the following year.
Exactly.
And there was the Americans suggested a skyhook to get Pol Pot out, and the Australians said they would be prepared to have him, to hold him for an international tribunal. So Pol Pot's concerns were not sort of, didn't come from nowhere.
No, and so I think his death was not natural.
Right. No, I suspect he was bumped off. But anyway, so look, let's move along now. We have Nayan Chanda in Delhi, who was the editor of the Far East in the Economic Review, the author of Brother, I've forgotten the name.
Brother Enemy,
it's gone out of my mind. Nayan, what was it like at the offices of the Far Eastern Economic Review dealing with basically two of the best scoops of the 20th century? The review at that time is a relatively small magazine. I mean, it's at less than 100,000. This is of global consequence. Can you give us a feeling of what the turmoil and activity that was going on at that time?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all for coming together to celebrate Nate's life. Nate's brother, Rob, just mentioned Nate had a dream. And I feel fortunate that I was kind of part of that dream going back to 8 years. In 1989, I had taken 1 year sabbatical from the review to be at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. And I had a call from someone called Nate Thayer wanting to see me. And he came to the Washington office, the Carnegie Endowment, and he explained to me what he wanted to do. And he was actually going to go to the Thai-Cambodia border as a stringer for AP. And also wanted to know if there is any possibility of his filing for the review. And so we discussed that. And he then told me that his plan was to find Pol Pot and interview him. And he discussed some of the things he wanted to do. And in the 8 years since I had seen him, he was single-minded. People may not realized that he was doing many stories, spending a lot of time in the border, hanging out with the KPNLF Khmer Rouge. But one thing that he never let go from his mind is his desire to find Pol Pot and interview him to ask him what he did, why did he do it. And then I ask you to jump forward to 1997. In October, I was then in the Far Eastern Economic Review office in Hong Kong. At lunchtime, the phone rang, and I picked up the phone, and the other end of the phone was a distinct Cambodian Khmer voice speaking in French, asking me whether he could speak to Nate Thayer. And Nate Thayer, I informed him that was not there, but is there any message I can pass on to Nate Thayer? And they said, yes, the uncle would see him. So that was the cryptic message that I received with phone call from Paris. And then my task was to find Nate. Nate has been very elusive since the July coup. He has been kind of hiding out in some place in Phnom Penh, sometimes in Battambang. And I sent out all point message asking him to contact me. And indeed he called me on a borrowed satellite phone from some UN official from Battambang. And I told him that uncle would see you, so that you know where to go. And then his problem was, how does he go to the border? He was in Battambang. And he suggested some of the ideas he had. One idea was to actually get a ride on the APC of the regime to the border. I said, absolutely not. You cannot go on an APC and you'd be a combatant. Then he said, well, how about if I can find an elephant? So he wanted to ride an elephant to the border. That idea also was shot down as not very practical. But eventually he managed to go to Phnom Penh and catch a flight to Bangkok. And the rest of the story you heard very nicely. So he's, after we learned from him that he has actually gone to the border, then our problem was that this is a sort of world scoop and how we keep the secret. So we actually set up a different server in the office, which they accessed only to three people, and nobody in the office else knew about this. And the server was used for storage of messages from Nate and to Nate. And we arranged for a senior editor from the review, Andrew Sherry, to actually fly down to Bangkok and rent a hotel room and work with Nate to produce the copy. And Nate was a terrific reporter, and he needed some help to organize the story, which was going to be a sort of world scoop. And so Andrew Sherry went down there, and as planned, it worked out. Nate returned to the hotel, to this place, and our review secretary, Phnom Penh, was charged with bringing all the films that Nate brought back. She flew to Hong Kong carrying the film herself, which was then processed to produce the cover and other images we produced in the review. So it was a very, very dramatic, exciting time. And I cannot thank Nate for giving that scoop to us to review. And he sort of achieved his dream through all the troubles he went through and all the hardship he went through. He was a reporter's reporter.
Have I got sound? No sound, Julian. Okay. Right, thank you, Nyan. We happen to have in the club tonight Seth Meidens of the New York Times, who wrote the obituary of Nate. He's been writing rather a lot of obituaries lately. What was the reaction to in the New York Times to this massive scoop when Elizabeth Becker got closed out? What was the reaction there?
No, I don't think there was. I'm not aware of any reaction in the New York Times. I covered Nate's two visits to the border, and they were just stories that I wrote. Before that, when Nate's material first came out, before the review had it, and when ABC put it out, the New York Times got material from it. And Elizabeth Becker herself wrote the story about the trial that he attended. So she was involved there. And it was after that, I'm sure, that she attempted to get the interview. But I don't know any further outcome from that.
All right, so now we're going to play Sympathy for the Devil, which is not the music, but it's Nate talking about the book that he planned to write about his amazing scoop with Pol Pot, but also his whole time in Cambodia when he was reporting on all the developments. So let's have a look at that one.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
My name is Nate Thayer. I am a journalist. It's not what I do, it's actually who I am. Pol Pot killed 2 million people in 3 years, 8 months, and 20 days. No one had seen Pol Pot for nearly 20 years. No one had ever talked to him, no one had ever interviewed him, no one had ever taken his picture. And I spent 15 years in the jungles of Cambodia looking for him. Really, what I wanted to know is, why the fuck did you kill 2 million people? And are you sorry?
Pleased to meet you. Hope you get my name. Oh, yeah.
What I'm planning on doing is creating a historical record of the mass murder and genocide that took place in Cambodia just in the last few decades, available to anybody who wants it. It will be probably 400 pages, it's now 800 pages, hardcover book filled with pictures. It will be released as an ebook, even though I've actually never read an ebook, but everyone else on the planet has, and I understand that it's important. So if you want to just get an overview of it, you can, but if you want to delve off into the minutiae of the historical record, it's all there. It will be unredacted. It will be raw interviews.
Your fellow Cambodians want to know whether you feel any remorse.
The issue is freedom. Investigative journalism is vital. There is no such thing as a free people or a free country without a free press. So for me, it's personally exciting. I'm able to take my life work and allow anybody who has an interest in it to access
it. Get down.
Right, well, the book, of course, didn't come out, and it's, as often remarked, it's one of the great historical losses for this part of the world, that Nate's account has yet to be published, and there's all sorts of stories about it. We're trying to get Michael Hayes online from Phnom Penh, but he's having technical trouble. So I'd like to go to you, Mark Dodd, in Australia. You've written very, very insightfully about Nate on Facebook posts and elsewhere lately. Can you give us a feeling of what Nate hoped to do with this book? And why you feel it didn't happen in the end?
Well, thanks, Dominic, and hi, everyone. Firstly, we live in this 24-hour news cycle, and I'd just like to refer back to Mark LeBaron's film. I mean, what an extraordinary piece of journalism that was. Absolutely, you know, just stunning to see that. What happened to the book? I think it was Nate was a little torn between what direction to take it. This is just a personal view that on one level he wanted it to be this sort of historical, political, academic narrative. And I think perhaps, you know, myself and perhaps a lot of his colleagues felt that it would have been better to combine elements of that, but also just the whole experience, the 15 years that he referred to just a little bit earlier, this whole hunt to track down, you know, one of the century's worst mass murderers. And whether the project stalled because of that conflict, it's hard for me to really say, but that's my view. And interestingly, my first, and I knew Nate for a number of years as we were sort of professional rivals, if you like, in Cambodia during my tenure there for 5 years. And I met him on the border. Our beginning was actually quite adversarial because the press corps in Bangkok at that time, I'm talking 1989, just before, 1989, the time when the Vietnamese had just pulled out of Cambodia, withdrawn, there was a split in the press corps. And I felt that there was an element, you know, there was a cohort, if you like, who was sympathetic to the PRK that became the Cambodian People's Party under Hun Sen and Heng Samrin, and another cohort that was essentially sympathetic to the non-communist resistance and obviously their allies, uneasy allies, the Khmer Rouge. And my first meeting with Nate was actually quite terse and adversarial. They were, when Nate came in to arrived in Cambodia to head up the AP Bureau, and that was the end of latter part of 91, actually, when I set the Royal Bureau, we eventually became much better friends, good friends, and we went out in a number of jobs together, and our differences narrowed considerably. He was an absolutely wonderful person. I think Nate's strength as a journalist was his ability to call things as he saw them, and I think that's a phenomenal strength as a journalist. Didn't mean that I had to agree with him, but after we had some very strong disagreements, but I thought that was that was perhaps his core strength.
Tell us the Fulroy Montagnard story. Was there a dispute between you and Nate about who actually got that scoop?
Well, there's no dispute. I mean, and the Reuters archive record will show that I had the scoop 2 days before. Now, we were both working on the story, and I can quite declare where it came from. There was an SAS corporal, his name was Fraser McKenzie, and he was based with the Uruguayans. And he'd been out on patrol with the Fulro, and reported the existence of this ancient insurgent group on the Cambodian-Vietnam border. And he reported it down the line to Captain Peter Batu, and then reported it to General John Sanderson. Now, Batu happened to be a sort of friend. I got to know him quite well, and he tipped me off about the existence of this insurgent group. And I prepared the story, and this is when Reuters was based in the Pilin Hotel. And we were going to go to press on a Tuesday. And Nate came up to the hotel. He'd been tipped off that I had the story, and asked whether we could delay it for 2 days, which was the publication date or the deadline for the Far Eastern Economic Review. And Kevin Cooney, my boss, laughed him out of the room and said, it's not how we work. It's the story by going up on the Reuters wire will actually excite interest in your own readership, and it'll kick the story along. But he really believed that we might be able to consider holding an important story like that for 2 days.
Great. I'm going to go now to Philip Blenkinsop, who's waiting. We have a few other people in line. Philip, you hung out tremendously with Nate over the years, High Times and all that. Just tell us what your take is on the lifestyle issue and where that might have contributed to what came along later.
Well, first of all, hello to you all. I can't see any of you now, but I've lost you. But it's lovely to see so many familiar faces. I think I think the things that I have to say about Nate, it's very, very different because we never actually worked together. And I think that allowed us to have a very wonderful relationship. I think you said hung out tremendously together. I think dangerously together would probably be the words that I would choose, because it was always the only times we would see each other, whether it would be in Cambodia or occasionally Burmese border, and often in Bangkok, of course, was when we were both back from places and just enjoying each other's company. He felt like a brother to me, really, and I think the fact that we never worked together, there was never any conflict. I mean, Nate was, he was obviously larger than life. I wrote to Robert earlier. I think one of the things that strikes me, Nate was, he encompassed these incredible extremes. He was a man of uncompromising integrity. And at the same time, he had this, I think for many people, they found it an incredibly frustrating trait, that he was this, he had this incredibly irreverent, mischievous sense of humor. And he had no breaks, Nate, and I think that's why I was so drawn to him. I think why so many others were drawn to him. He just you felt very alive when you were around him. I think everybody would agree. I never had those frustrations because I wasn't trying to work with him, as I say, but he always had people around that were trying to glean information from him. So I think in our relationship there was probably some kind of shelter. I don't think I ever asked him for anything. I know I didn't ever, even when I probably could have had information, it was just a no-go area because I wanted to protect our friendship. I probably lost track of the thread here, Dominic. Can you say something again so I can see you?
Basically, you weren't his enemy professionally, and he was ruthless when he went for his stories. Let's be absolutely clear about that. I was interested. I mean, living dangerously together, how destructive do you think that was? And what do you think about this whole issue of a journalist who becomes the story?
Well, I think that some people, that's just how some people are. I was talking to a dear friend earlier, Alan Pierce, who many of you probably remember. And he said, he was this kind of Hemingway figure for a lot of writers. And you couldn't really take Nate out of the story because he was such an incredible figure. He was exciting to be around. He was the story. He had this incredible energy. I think a lot of people found it kind of hard to keep up with him. And that adage, work hard, play hard. I think you know, he worked incredibly hard, and he played you know, and you know, he loved to say my body is my temple, which of course it wasn't. I was saying to Alan also this morning, I said, I mean, Alan and I are both fond of a drink, you know, as I think many of us are, many of us. But I think, you know, next to Nate, we look like Mary Poppins, you know. I mean, Nate would really go out. I remember wonderful evenings with Nate, one in particular, actually, driving around Phnom Penh. I don't know where we've been, but we were quite incapacitated and on motos and just riding around looking for something. And we came across this was after I'd managed to pick Nate up. He'd spilled on a corner, and we put him back on the bike, and we both got on our scooters. And we ended up about 20 minutes later leading a group of Khmer motodop riders and people, believe it or not, on roller skates, who had formed a kind of conga snake up round the Independence Monument and down through street restaurants. I mean, it was absolute pandemonium, and this is the kind of thing that could very easily happen when you went out and had a drink with Nate. I think it was obviously self-destructive. You can't live like that and expect to live forever. He was wonderful. I found him to be just a wonderfully generous, charismatic, one in a million, once in a lifetime, you know. And it's been lovely to see the footage of him today, because the last time I was with Nate was I think in about 2009, if memory serves. It was in Bangkok, and he wasn't doing very well, and he was staying with Heather Kelly, and I spent a bit of time with him. We chatted together last year, but I haven't managed to reach him in the last months. But seeing that the footage of him is really how I remember him. It's a little bit like a time capsule. It's how when I think of him and I hear his voice, it's how I see him. It's that young man, and I love him very much, and I will miss him terribly.
Thank you very much, Philip. Your studio looks absolutely beautiful, by the way.
Right. It's not my studio, actually. No, I'm in the middle of installing a show at the Seven Academy.
Oh, it's not your castle. Okay.
No, it's a bit Spartan for my likes, for my tastes, Dominic.
Anyway, you're looking good. Hurry over. We're going to go to the next person coming up. Is a familiar name. Paul Handley. Paul, can you switch on your camera so that we can actually see you? I wonder if he's got it running in background. Whilst he's doing that, Paul Handley obviously worked for the Far Eastern Economic Review. So he is one of the people who was in the crew in Bangkok in the early 90s. And Paul was around Nate when we were covering the May 1992 uprising. Right, well, we'll get him later. Michael Schenken, can you hear me? Oh, wait a minute, Paul's coming online. Sorry, Michael, just hang on a second. What's wrong? Okay, well, he can come back to us when he's ready. So, Michael?
Yes.
So you knew Nate from the Indochina days. You were working with the UNDP and other organizations along the border. And you followed up with him, and you were one of the people in recent months who had been a good friend to him and visited him regularly. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. I first met his older brother, Rob, in Thailand in 1980-81 when we both worked for the International Rescue Committee. And I spent my working life with the humanitarian community, the United Nations agencies, and in the different non-governmental organizations. I just want to comment a little bit on some of the earlier notes of the participants. There was an excellent description of Nate as a loner who craved personal contact. I think he was also very much a humanitarian at heart. I felt he cared deeply about Cambodia, its people, and he really wanted that story of the suffering they endured to be told in a way that it simply couldn't be forgotten, never again. And he was really willing to take extraordinary risks to investigate that story. I think risks that others might consider quite extreme. Many of the humanitarian workers, relief workers at that time and today have a very high tolerance to risk, at least by ordinary standards. But I think most of us found ourselves with jaws dropping and shaking our heads when Nate would start recounting his stories from the camping trips, as he called them, his forays across Cambodia in the late 1980s, during the time where there was a vicious conflict between the resistance groups and the government in Cambodia. And it wasn't ever really clear which piece of territory belonged to which faction at what time. So clearly high risk. And the stories he would recount gave us a perspective of what was going on in the country and gave balance to our own personal experiences that we had limited to what we saw and heard and experienced on the border, in the border camps and in the territory immediately adjacent to the Thai-Cambodian border. I think there's a story that I wanted to just tell everyone that in 1990 that I think illustrates that commitment to humanitarian principles, but it also kind of gives an idea how Nate could get some of those stories. In 1993, Nate, myself, and a UN colleague, we interviewed defectors from the Khmer Rouge. Now, these were some small group of Tamok soldiers who had walked away from An Long Vang and surrendered to the Cambodian government at some point near at the front lines. Now, these were very hardened individuals. They had seen a lot of combat, and their skin on their arms showed evidence of having been burned with cigarettes. And I found myself, none of us, we didn't have a translator, all of us spoke enough Cambodian to get through this. And the challenge was, how do you start a conversation with that group? Well, Nate was chewing tobacco and he reached into his pocket and pulled out a cigarette and gave the three defectors cigarettes and then lit those cigarettes. And then we just sat in silence until Nate asked a question. And I forget exactly how he opened the conversation, but within a few minutes, they were telling us their stories. They were telling us about their families. They were telling us about their experiences in An Long Vang, their decisions, the motivations for their decisions to defect, and their experiences since arriving in the government, past the government lines. And it was fascinating. It also showed to me that he really had a way of reaching out and connecting with people from all walks of life and patiently listening to them tell their story. And in doing so, he could then describe what he had seen, what he had learned. And his descriptions, I think, were fascinating to me as a consumer of his writing, and my friends who were avid consumers of everything he wrote. There was discussion of, can we separate him from the story? And he's also been referred to as a gonzo journalist. And I think what really struck me about his writing was that his descriptions captured the complete absurdity of some of the situations and stories that he was reporting on. Why did something like this happen? And he just wouldn't stop asking that question until he had at least a fuller picture of the circumstances, the actors, and the actions that resulted in, experiences and feelings that resulted in the actions he was reporting on, or the situation he was reporting on. I think, for me, the other good example of his humanitarian commitment was the way he approached the Full Row story. The Full Row, as someone earlier mentioned, it was simply a report in an UNTAC battalion's communications to headquarters about this discovery of a group of villagers who had come out of Vietnam. And it was Nate's reporting that ensured that this did not end there, that it resulted in the safe transport, the safe journey of that entire community of people who I think could fairly be described as refugees to the United States, where they live today. And I remember this personally because there was a follow-up group of two individuals who came out after their initial group had been resettled in the United States. And I think they called them the Lost Patrol, and Phnom Penh Post wrote a story about that. And I can remember reading that and just fascinated by that whole story, having read Nate's articles on Full Row and following that situation. And then all of a sudden there were two more people. And we were at a party in Phnom Penh at the house of someone from the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. And for some reason, Nate decided he was going to climb up on the roof of that house. And he did. And he wanted to take a look at, I think there was a drop off at the edge of the tile roof. And it came straight through right above where the party was being held. And he, I can remember just hearing this enormous crash, and then a leg came through the roof tile. And then another leg came through the roof tile. Unfortunately, he ended up straddling a steel support beam, and he pulled himself back up, came back down to rejoin the party, and the host of the party came up and asked me, "Well, what happened?" I said, "I think that was Nate trying to walk on your roof, and he broke through the tiles, and that was the shattering of tiles. Fortunately, on the floor, two stories below, fortunately, no one was injured, including Nate. He came down, we resumed the conversation, and then I asked permission to go pick up those two individuals from their, the Uruguayan, and at that point, I think they had handed over to the Indian battalion. We picked up those two people and brought them back to Phnom Penh, and they eventually were interviewed and then resettled and were able to rejoin their community in North Carolina. And I mention that only because Nate really focused on people. It was not just soldiers in that group, it was also their family members. So there were a lot of people who were not combatants, and he was able to report on stories that for all their absurdity had a human element, and he somehow managed to capture that human element and bring that to light for the rest of us, and help motivated us to take actions that we wouldn't necessarily have taken if we hadn't read those stories, or have a perspective that we wouldn't have had. So that's my memory of Nate as a professional, as a good friend. We met in mid-80s, and we remained friends, and had lots of wild times in Phnom Penh in the 1990s. When I found myself back in the United States after the pandemic, I reached out to Nate. We reconnected. He told me of his illnesses and his struggles to maintain his independence and movement. And I visited him in August of this year. And the prior year, he came and stayed with my family out in the Berkshires. So he left the ocean and explored the mountains for a little while. with his dog Lamont. They stayed with us for a couple of weeks. We went down to the beach quite often when I visited him in Falmouth. And he was lucid, as Rob said, and full of stories, wanted to just talk, and was full of piss and vinegar when he was talking about the medical community. But I think he really wanted to be back in touch with so many people, and that GoFundMe campaign that people put together and all the resulting communications about his plight and his condition, his plight and his medical condition and his feelings resulted in the communication he needed to help him go through the last part of his life. At least knowing that he was loved and had friends all over the world who cared deeply about him. And I think on that note, I'll...
Yeah, Michael, thanks very much. That was very, very moving. We will now go to Paul Handley, who is not able to switch on his camera, but he can hear us and he will be able to speak to us. Paul, we haven't seen you around here for a bit. What's going on? Paul? Right, well, whilst Paul's recovering himself, I'm going to... Is Heather there? Heather's not online yet. I'm just going to go to Jim Fox, who was the first person to give Nate a job in Thailand. Is that correct?
Well, I think we may have had something to do about that. Jim Wolf. I was with AFP News Agency in the early 1980s in Bangkok. And I got a call from Nate at the border. I'm having a little bit of trouble pinning down the time frame, because I've heard some say that Nate began on the border in 1984, and I would have thought that he might have actually been there a little bit earlier, because I have the vague notion that he was calling to offer his services as a stringer perhaps as early as 1983. But either way, we hired Nate, and I think we beat AP to him, and I like to think that we had a role in giving him a forum that let him show his talents and put to good effect the work that was earlier described as having involved in-depth knowledge of Ranarit and the KPNLF hierarchies. And that was key to the coverage that we had from the border in the 1983-1984 period, when the U.S. was pushing to, the U.S. and allies were pushing to put the KPNLF into a coalition government with the Khmer Rouge and with the Sihanoukists. So Son San's KPNLF and Ranarit's Phun Sin Pek were a big story and the focus of lots of international interest and a cockpit of great power competition at the time. And so it was great to have somebody like Nate, who was already steeped in the politics of these groups, feeding us stuff from the border that helped enrich our report from Bangkok.
Thank you, Jim Wolf. I'm sorry about that. And you were the deputy bureau chief for AFP at that time. Yeah, correct. At least I got that right. So somebody else's name I muddled up lately, Phil Robertson. You saw Nate in Falmouth in August. Are your hands clean?
Yeah. They are, thank you. Thanks, Dominic. Actually, I was with Nate
in August and September this past year with actually with Michael Shankman. We actually went over there a couple different times. There's a photo also. My wife, Room, took him some Thai food, homemade, which he was quite thrilled about. He was so thrilled about that he later turned up at our house another day for dinner. You know, and I heard a cock 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 on the front door. I was like, "Hey, Nate, how are you doing?" And he'd driven over, and driving at that point for Nate was a little bit difficult because he couldn't feel his feet. And it was really, I mean, it was kind of hazardous. He couldn't really feel, he said, you know, it's really dangerous. I can't feel the difference between the brake and the accelerator. And there we are right there. That's my wife, Rung, with Nate and Rod, who actually ended up taking care of Lamont. You asked, a lot of people want to know what happened to Lamont. Rod is taking care of Lamont. He's a Antifa activist and was actually very helpful when Nate almost died earlier this spring, the spring of 2022, when he had sepsis and he ended up in the hospital in Falmouth. But I had known Nate was around in Falmouth, and surprisingly, because somebody contacted me, and I went and saw him back in 2019. And he was basically, for a number of years, living as a caretaker at various different people's sort of places and taking care of this. And he had his dog, Lamont, and he had a whole routine. He was going every day to the beach with Lamont. You know, he was talking to people in the town. He was, you know, going to the food pantry. You know, people were taking care of him as he was feeling getting less well, shall I say. But he was, as Michael said, full of stories, constantly talking, wanted to reach out to people, wanted to talk. He was talking about, you know, reaching out to this person, that person. You know, his Facebook was sort of his lifeline to reach out to different people. And it was really rather amazing. And, you know, I had known Nate also when he went to Washington, D.C. He was a fellow at the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies for a year. He got a fellowship there and was there ostensibly to write his book, which, of course, didn't happen. But he did tear up Washington quite a bit. There was quite a bit of fun and excitement. You know, his house in Tacoma Park, which was right down the street from my house, he was there with Carol Bean. It was, you know, day and night, there was a party going on. And, you know, Nate was, he was irrepressible. It was exciting to be around. I mean, I remember very clearly the first time I met him was back, I think, in 1988. And he was coming to Washington, D.C. I was working at the House Foreign Affairs Committee. There were all these congressmen who cared about Cambodia and were interested in Cambodia. And all of a sudden, this guy, Nate, who everybody had heard, knew everything about Cambodia and had been almost been blown up, and was coming. And it was interesting watching these congressmen treat him like a rock star. You know, he was like the guy from the field who was going to tell them what was really going on. And it was like, it was like the congressman groupies, you know. And Nate was loving it, and he was dishing stories and telling stuff like that, and the congressmen were like gobbling it up. And the staff were like, oh my God, everybody wanted to take a picture with him. At that time, you had to actually sort of plan for a picture because it wasn't all these cell phones, so somebody had to be around with a camera. But it was amazing, and you know, you still got that sense even when Nate, in August and September this past year. You know, I mean, he was in some ways very realistic. He said, look, I know this is a situation where it's quite bad. You know, the doctor keeps saying he wants to take my leg off. I'm not going to let him, you know, because he couldn't feel anything below his knees. He was really, I mean, it was, you know, and you know, he was moving around with a walker. So it was, he knew that there was just a matter of time, I think. But he was not letting go. He was seizing everything and doing whatever he could. So, you know, I mean, it was good to be able to sort of help him in the last days. It was, you know, when it mattered that, you know, he was eating Rung's Thai food. And he was like, oh, I've missed this so much. This is amazing. You know, the Thai, and we're talking about Thai food, and the Thai food in the town of Falmouth is, you know, not very good. There's a couple restaurants, but, you know, it's a typical bland Thai food in the United States. And he was so appreciative of everybody. He's like, I love this town. I love the people here. I love Massachusetts. You know, as he said, I moved to Massachusetts because I could get the insurance. You know, Mitt Romney, as governor, passed insurance in Massachusetts that enabled him to get free health care, and that was important to him. And, you know, he animated right through and through. And even, you know, I think if he had reservations, he felt that, you know, it was a matter of time. He was still going to tell his stories, and he was still going to really try to get everything out of it. And it was amazing, and right to the end.
Thanks, Phil. All right, we've got an iPhone on that's come up. We're going to try and talk to it. It might be Michael Hayes or Heather. Who is there?
Dominique, Paul Hanley here. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Paul, how are you
doing? I'm sorry, technical problems. Look, I can wait for Michael if you got Michael on the line.
No, we want to hear from you. So we've been wondering where you got to in these last few years, but anyway, you're back.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry, I'd like to get back, but, you know, things get a little difficult sometimes, so everyone knows the story. But the story's not about me. It's about Nate today, so...
Okay,
anyway.
Paul, you were working. He's one of your colleagues in the Bureau in the early 90s. What are your recollections of him? How did you get on with him?
Well, a couple things to start with. First, I worked in FEAR through 2004. I mean, 1994. Sorry about that. And I was covering Thailand. I wasn't part of the large group of people who made their careers started their careers on Cambodia, and for Nate it was his career. And so I wasn't part of that group on the border, and so I ran across him only sporadically in different situations, in bars in the evening sometimes. We talked a lot during the upheavals of 1991 in the Suchinda coup and what was happening on the street. Then later, I remember another experience with Nate was I was in Phnom Penh on the eve of the great Kupre hunt and took part in the so-called preparations for that, which involved a lot of drink and weed and lots of guns and things like that. Here in Washington, we had a number of interactions in the 2000s and early 2010s. Let me go back and comment on what an earlier person said. I was one of the people who, writing about his death, called him a gonzo journalist, and I did so not easily, but I did meet the original gonzo journalist a long, long time ago, Hunter Thompson. And what struck me about Hunter Thompson was, beyond his reputation, is that he spoke of getting the story out there without the filters of corporate journalism, without the filters of people's politics. He was really dedicated to getting the story and letting people understand what it was really about without all the formalities, all the structures of traditional journalism. And I think that's what Nate was about. So, yeah, he suited Hunter Thompson's bigger-than-life crazy lifestyle, but he also was really focused on informing people and getting to the nub of the story himself, even if he became part of the story and his lifestyle became part of the story. So I think Gonzo fits, but you have to understand that Gonzo has that deeper meaning. We argued in December in 1991 about what was happening on the streets, the shootings of people, and we had different views of things that happened. But journalism is about putting together everyone's views and seeing what you see, reporting it, and understanding that other people see different things. And I think that was Nate wanted to get the things, see the things himself and not depend on what other people said. And that's what, and he was really dedicated to that. There were other times where you saw other things from Nate, but the most recent experience I had with him was in 2013. So if anyone was around U.S. journalism in that period, that was the time when there was an explosion of online media, magazines, new online magazines with their verticals of different things and trying to fill up space with no money. In this case, Nate had written about North Korea and written a good story about North Korea and basketball diplomacy. And he was asked by Atlantic Magazine, which is a big institution in Washington, but was also trying desperately to fill up a lot of internet space to be able to compete with this big shakeout of the media business that the internet had brought. And so there was a person, an editor, who contacted him and said, "We like your North Korea story. We'd like you to write it up for us too." And then said, we can't offer you any money, but we can offer you the idea that we have a million, 2 million regular viewers and you can, become famous." And Nate was livid about that. And he should have been. Again, it was a different era from even now. There's been a big shift in journalism since then. But at that time, all these online publications were offering people peanuts for stuff. And he was livid. He's like, and he didn't say, "Do you know who I am?" He said, "We have to make livings and you guys have money. And I have to pay my insurance. I don't have insurance. I have to pay my rent. I have to pay other things. And you're asking me to write for your million-dollar business for free." And he was livid. And his point was, he was really standing up for journalism as for people to respect journalists and not take advantage of them. He wasn't even negotiating how much money. He was really insulted by the fact that this business could just say, "Oh, well, we're going to make you famous." He wasn't doing it for the fame, but he also knew, even if he didn't act like it, he knew he had to live and had to make some money. And so that spilled into another thing that was happening back then. It still happens, is the kind of internet mob where there were all these people in Washington, younger online editors, people who were starting their careers on these new websites. And they ganged up online to attack Nate and saying, "Who do you think you are? There are other people who will write for free." Some of those people have actually become quite famous and worked for and made their careers to big publications. And they were working for peanuts then. But they ganged up on him. And Nate and I talked about how to deal with the internet mob. We exchanged a few emails and calls. He didn't seek out my help. We were just talking about it generally. And, I tried to give him some advice about how to deal with it. But it was too late. Even if he clammed up and said, "Okay, you guys just do your mob, do your hit squad," he was pretty savaged in this town, and he didn't deserve that. He deserved a lot of respect for speaking up for lots of journalists who were being asked to work for nothing, and I think that's part of his his personality was not, you know, he didn't want to make himself the story. He had a point he had to make, and he was right. Now, we all know, unfortunately, that Nate was never good at managing his personal life in terms of his finances and monetizing his work. But he stood up for us, and, you know, good on him for that.
Right, Paul, do you happen to remember the night at the Royal Hotel when Chum Long moved the crowd and you and other people were with Nate there? Do you have a recollection of it?
I was in and out. I wasn't hanging with Nate at that time. I was kind of, you know, we would pass each other and I would pass the others, but I didn't stay in the hotel. So no, I don't remember a lot of details from that. I remember them bringing bodies into the hotel and then basically myself running out and trying to get an idea of what was going to happen. Because I worked for a weekly and wasn't reporting that night. So no, I don't remember too much. I remember a bit on, you know, the next days. And it was the next days when we were talking about, you know, what had happened and what we saw. And, you know, lots of respect for him for getting out in the crowd and seeing stuff. And again, we had a debate about who was doing what, but in a way, we were both right, ultimately.
Dominique, I was in the Royal Hotel with Nate on the mezzanine floor that day, or that evening.
Yeah, Mark, how many journalists do you think were rounded up by the Thai army on the Tuesday morning when they stormed the hotel?
Yeah, look, all our rooms were emptied and we were all sheltering Thais. And their first act when they started clearing the rooms of the media was to drag out all the Thai students, you know, young men and women, and tied them up with their shirts and had them crawling down the steps. And we were forced out onto the mezzanine floor, seated next to Richard Vogel and Nate.
Right.
And they were bundled out and then they were put on lorries. And I was with, I think later, Jeremy Wagstaff, and we went out on the balcony and a sniper took a pot shot at us. I don't think, I mean, if he wanted to kill us, he probably could. My view was that he saw us taking photographs of these Thais being bundled onto trucks and taken away, and they wanted to shoo us back inside. There was a very humorous incident that happened there, and all the journalists, I'm guessing there must have been at least about 20, 15 of us perhaps on this mezzanine floor. And this angry Lopburi Thai Special Forces guy had come in, and he was with the manager of the hotel, and they'd emptied out most of the rooms except one, which was on the mezzanine floor. And we were looking at each other and wondering. I asked Nate, "Oh, who the hell's in there that isn't coming out?" And the Thais were banging on the door and they're pounding on it. And the poor manager is absolutely harried. He can't sort of find the keys. And finally, we're all looking at this door, who's in there? And finally, the door opens and this sheepish German tourist comes out with a towel wrapped around his waist, with two girls who'd been bottled up in the room with him. And it was a moment of levity in an otherwise horrendous situation, Maddie, that whole day, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was just thinking of the Sunday night when, Paul, we were having dinner, you, me, Nate, and a spook from the American Embassy, and Chum Long moved the crowd. We were all bored out of our minds because this had been going on for weeks. And suddenly the crowd moved, and Nate belted out of the restaurant without paying the bill. And
okay, I do. Now that you raise that, I do
yeah,
remember it.
I never forgot it. But anyway, and then you and I paid the bill, and then you raced out, and this incredible crowd was going along Rajdhamnern, and I immediately lost you. Didn't see you again until you got onto the front page of Thai Art being arrested. And I lost Nate, of course, he wasn't around. And we went up to Penh Bridge. This is the Sunday. This is 2 days before they emptied the hotel. And there was this extraordinary scene of a completely peaceful crowd on the street and a full-blown riot going on over Penh Bridge on the small bridge on the right, where people were literally being killed. And Nate had gone round along a certain route and gone up this street, which had shop houses with steel gates. So basically it was a tunnel of steel. You could not get out. You could not escape. And he'd gone right up to the top, complete madness. They were throwing Molotov cocktails. The police were shooting. And he got himself well and truly thumped with truncheons, lost his telephone. I remember him catching up with us, and he was completely indignant that such a thing should have happened, that, you know, don't they know who I am, almost. But anyway, the point is that he really got into the thick of things when it was moving, when think they were going, and it was imprudent at times. The accident that he had, not the accident, but his near death in that truck, was miraculous. The two men on either side of him were killed, blown apart, and he survived because his legs were along the transmission. Anyway, I've spoken too much. There are people who might like to say something. I know Mikkel wants to say something. Karen, would you like to say something? It's all men so far.
Precisely why I think I should say something. But I've known Nate in so many of his lowest points, so it's hard to say something because I don't want to speak about low things in this kind of time. And that's how I know Nate. MP Noonan in New York is watching. She is a little kinder, maybe, than me. And she reminded me, well, I didn't have to be reminded, I do know that Nate had a good heart, even if he was unable to help himself. And that's how many of us women probably thought of him in the 90s and ever since, and why we tried to help him at various times. But MP from New York City went to visit Nate in Cape Cod a few times, and she remembered that how he would disappear sometimes from Facebook, because in Cape Cod he had a blog in which he would out right-wing extremists and neo-Nazis. They would then contact Facebook and say Nate was an extremist and would get the Facebook censors to block him. She was visiting, and he'd get harassing phone calls while she was there from these extremists. And he had death threats all the time, she said. So even as his life had gotten smaller in those times in Cape Cod, his journalism, she was seeing, was still frightening people. That was in 2019. She said the extremists also threatened to kill Lamont, which was, as you can imagine, would piss him off. I'm sitting next to Belinda Stewart Cox, who remembered talking with him poolside about the coupe that she also was in search of at some point. And she found Nate to be this obsessive character in a good way.
I think he was put in touch with me because I had been on the border with my late colleague and friend, Serb Nakasatian, in Khmer Rouge camps in pursuit of Kupre because there had been reports, and it came to nothing. But I had this theory about what the Kupre had been. And anyway, that's how I met Nate, and I didn't know him at all well, but I do remember meeting him by the pool a number of times, because he was a swimmer, as am I, and the pool of the Hilton Hotel. And I remember, we would had done our respective laps, we would talk, but I remember just this impression of these eyes, this face, this intensity of being interested in my story, but also wanting to tell me his. And I recall this impression of this obsessive focus, and a man who was hell-bent on this story to the point of, I didn't know whether it was brave or reckless or both. And I also remember thinking, there is a child in there that is bursting to get out. There's a child still in this obsessive, ruthlessly brave adult.
Thank you. Right, we've run for nearly 2 hours, so it's time to wrap it up soon. Mikhail, did you want to say something? Can't find you. Oh, there you are.
Thank you, Dominic. I met Nate in Aranyapatet in July of 1989. I came over on my own from holiday from the U.S. to go to the refugee camps. And I was staying at the Inter Hotel, and one of the staff said, you need to meet this guy. And I said, well, what's his name? And he said, it's Nate, but he's not here right now. So later that evening, there was a knock on the door, and I open up the door, and Nate's very serious, as usual. He goes, I hear you're looking for me. And I said, well, yeah, but I don't know who you are. But he said, well, what do you do? I said, well, I'm a photographer. I was going to the camps. And he goes, well, tomorrow I'm going out along the border. There's been a lot of shelling going on. And you're welcome to come with me. So that was my first experience with artillery shelling as we headed for a bunker in this temple that had been getting shelled. So for the next couple weeks, I hung out with him. And he was very helpful to me. And eventually, he got a job for AP for me when Dith Prawn and Hang Nor came to site to see the Prawn's relatives that were still there. And they were heading to Cambodia for a story by the New York Times. And so, yeah, he was real helpful to me. And it was quite an experience traveling with him because he was very focused on what he wanted to do. Even then, he told me that he wanted to find Pol Pot. And we did go to a Barai gems market. And in that area, there was a checkpoint. And he, for some reason, he thought that some of the Khmer Rouge were up that road. So he goes, I'm going to go talk to him and see if we can go inside. So we went up to the border checkpoint, and Nate said, I want to go in there. I heard Tamuk might be there. And the guy just looked at us, and he goes, I cannot guarantee your safety. So he goes, okay. So we left, and we went over back to the car, and pretty soon about four guys came over, and they stood next to us, just staring us down. And I said, I think we better leave. So we did. But it was really interesting being around Nate. And, you know, we kept in contact over the years, and I was there during May 92 as well, along with Philip. Hello, Philip. And you know, he was a good friend, and the last time I saw him was when Tim Page was at the hospital. And at that time, Nate wasn't looking so good either. And it was really a shame because he was so focused on what he wanted to do, and he did accomplish what he wanted to do. And I admire him for that. And he just one of a kind, he really was. And he accomplished what he wanted to do. And it's a shame his book didn't get done. Okay, thank you.
Yep. So just on that last note that Mikhail brought up, Mark, the book, the unfinished book, the 800 pages manuscript, there's a lot of interest in that. Is there any chance of it being recovered? Is there any chance of competent editors being able to take it in hand and actually reconstruct or complete the legacy? What do you think?
Yeah, look, I'd love to see that project come to fruition. But first of all, who owns the title? Because I did understand that Nate was given a pretty hefty advance to complete the book. So I'm not sure what the legal status of the title is at the moment. I mean it was advertised for a while, but it really absolutely deserves to be see the light of day as one of Nate's finest legacies. And if there's anything that we can do to help advance that, then let's try and do it.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Well, it's a great shame that Michael Hayes had all these technical problems because he knows, he knows where the bodies are buried and which bits are what.
Nate had the manuscript when he was staying at the house here in 2010 and was working on it still then, so and here in Darkwood. So he certainly hadn't given up on it.
Okay, well, look, on that note, I'd like to wind things up and thank Nyan Chanda, Phil Blenkinsop, Mark Dodd, Michael Schenkman, and, of course, Paul Handley and Rob for joining us tonight. Much appreciated. Added a huge amount to the evening. We've had about 30, 40 people in here this evening, and it's gone out on a live stream. So I think that we've acknowledged the passing of somebody very unusual and certainly very interesting. Thank you all very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.